It sounds like a horror scenario for our planet. The population is inexorably growing. By 2.6 human beings each second, and that number is rising. Each minute, each day, each week, each month, each year. Today, it's already 2050 at least. Just over half the world now lives in cities. The number of megacities keeps increasing. Most of them are in developing nations. People in the megacities need water and food. Urban dwellers suffer more from hunger than their rural counterparts. Even today, nearly 500 million people worldwide do not have enough to eat. The world, however, produces enough food to feed everyone, theoretically. But a large part of that food never reaches the consumer. Why is that? One obvious reason is social inequality. The gap between rich and poor in India could hardly be bigger. But there are other serious reasons. Distribution and food waste, representing both a technical and logistical problem. India has the potential to play a key role in the global food supply. The subcontinent produces huge amounts of food, but there are also huge problems in supplying the cities with food in sufficient quantities. And for that, there are many reasons. According to official figures, about 40% of India's population is undernourished. 1.7 million children die before their fifth birthday, 90% of them from starvation. Hundreds of thousands live in degrading conditions on waste dumps of megacities, without clean water or sufficient food. Situations you'll find all over the world. Misery is widespread. 500 million people live on 70 cents a day, far below the poverty line. Hygiene when handling food is not self-evident. Adequate treatment of food is often impossible due to a lack of standards and the necessary equipment. Usually, cooked food is quite safe. Without access to clean water for dishwashing, however, there's no chance to break the cycle of infection. Due to inadequate sanitation, the streets turn into toilets. Weak people become infected by flies over and over again. It's actually because of social achievements that have been promoted by the population itself that hunger doesn't cause even more deaths. People in India fight hunger as best they can, without the support of institutions, and mostly relying on their own initiatives. The religious Sikhs show how charity works. Their most important sanctuary is the Gurudwara Bangla Sahib Temple in Delhi. In an enormous kitchen, they prepare food around the clock. Work is done by volunteers, the project financed by donations. Everyone can come here and have two free meals a day. The only conditions, bare feet and head covering. In accordance with their faith, the Sikh practice the principle of equality between men and women, between rich and poor. Therefore, the caste system has no relevance. 100,000 people a day have a warm meal at this temple. But with 19 million people in Delhi, this is just a drop in the ocean. Free food for the poor is also provided in more deprived areas. At noon and in the evening, people in need are gathering in front of the soup kitchens and wait for their meals.
Oh, uncle!
Abhi ek ek kya ho na? 7, 8, 9, 10. Bas, beta, bas.
The system is straightforward. Wealthy people donate money to the owner of the soup kitchen. The entire amount is used to produce the meals. Once the money is spent, the hungry have to wait for the next donor. The examples show that Indian people have developed creativity in dealing with their food supply. But charity is not enough. The authorities recognize that. India is projected to be the world's most populous country by 2050, with about 1.6 billion people. Even today, it's a problem to meet elementary needs. In India, as in nearly all poor countries, clean water is a scarce commodity. Principally, running water from either taps or pumps is classified as harmful to health because nobody knows where it comes from. India is symptomatic of poor countries worldwide, not only in terms of water. India's traffic conditions are also typical. As in most countries, the transport of people and goods is a disaster. Crashes, chaos, and endless traffic jams are standard. Free rides are impossible on the dusty rural roads. Each journey seems to take an eternity. It takes a truck 5 days to travel the 1,500 kilometers from the business metropolis Mumbai to the capital, New Delhi. And then, there's the waiting to cross the borders of the autonomous regions. Small merchants and wholesalers are flocking from all over the country to the urban centers. The megacities of India, Mumbai, Delhi, and Kolkata, are at the point of collapse. India is symptomatic of the problems of all developing and emerging nations. Megacities are sprawling, widely uncontrolled, social gaps are widening, and distribution problems are increasing. By 2030, two-thirds of the world's population will live in megacities, the majority in degrading conditions, without water, electricity, sanitation, and without sufficient food. Farmers and merchants sell rural food products at urban markets. People are sorting out spoiled fruit and vegetables all over the place. About 40% of the goods spoil during transport from field to consumer. Food products suffer from long transport chains and from the lack of cooling facilities and storage capacities in transit. Moreover, the products have no protective cover or packaging. Fruit and vegetables usually lay on trucks or push carts for days without any protection. The products are ruined by parasites, wither in the sun, or rot in the rain. Experts have been clear about the problem for years, demanding government action.
Reduce losses, I think we need food processing, for which we need investment. Then logistic improvement is needed. For example, transportation. We need better trucks and transports and roads so that fruits and vegetables are supplied immediately to the marketplaces, to the consumers.
Transport, processing and packaging are the problem children of India's food processing industry. People try to minimize food losses by simple measures, but a poor infrastructure leaves them with a nearly insoluble problem. About half of all Indians work in agriculture. Farmers, merchants, and carriers have, for many years, been urging the government to build warehouses and cold stores. But little so far has been done. Fruit and vegetables continue to rot. India is actually an extremely productive country. The monsoon rains usually ensure two crops a year. In some regions, vegetables such as cauliflower can be harvested up to four times a year. If India didn't have such a poor infrastructure, the country would have no problem in meeting its own food supply, and that of many other nations. Food processing, though, is not unknown in India. On the contrary, it has a long tradition. More than 6,000 years ago, sugarcane was introduced to India. Freshly cut sugarcane is extremely perishable. Early on, people learned that it's quite easy to preserve the sweet juice. Since then, juice has been squeezed from the sugarcane. The remaining fiber, called bagasse, is used for animal feed or, after being dried, as a fuel. During boiling, the juice slowly thickens. After the evaporation process, at the end of the processing chain, what remains is a sticky, tasty mass. The mass is stable and easy to transport, and it can also be refined into crystalline sugar.
Mankind has always tried to save and preserve for future requirement that cannot be immediately consumed. India also is rich in traditional food processing. But in the modern context, the food processing is gaining momentum in the country as more and more people are gravitating towards processed food because of their convenience and food safety and quality aspects.
India already has a small packaging industry. Little colorful bags of snacks can be found at every kiosk, but it's a long way from being a sound, powerful industry. Once the first step is taken in establishing food processing industries, other branches will soon follow. This canned mango juice concentrate has traveled thousands of kilometers without damage. It comes from southern India. In a small factory on the outskirts of Delhi, it's processed into handy thirst quenchers with tasty mango juice. In a complex procedure, the water is filtered and sterilized. That is the only way to make it safe for the consumer. Here also, safety and hygiene in food production are essential. Health is the greatest wealth. Modern logistics, processing technologies, and packaging are essential to meet these requirements. In addition, India will have to adjust to its fast-growing urban population. There's a chicken factory in Sonipat, in the state of Haryana. Poultry is the widest consumed meat in India. The increasing urban population is causing lasting changes in patterns of consumption. Urban dwellers don't keep chickens, nor do they buy live animals. They depend on meat that has been packed under satisfactory conditions. Small businesses, however, are able to supply only the regional market. For longer distances, an uninterrupted cold chain would be necessary. And there lies the problem. According to the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, the FICCI, India's chilled storage capacity can meet only 15% of annual food production. And so, food waste continues. Only a very small share of production is further processed in India. 7% of fruit and vegetables and 21% of meat. The government aims to increase that to 35% by 2025. An ambitious plan.
India has the potential to become world's food basket. In terms of food production, we are first, second or third in vegetables, fruits, milk, fish and eggs. All this speaks well of India's role in the world food production across various subsectors. With the easy facilities for direct foreign investments, we are expecting international technologies and machineries to be adapted for Indian situation and closer involvement of countries which are the world leaders in food processing.
India aims for leadership in the global food processing industry. Mega food parks are established all over the country. The government provides infrastructure such as buildings, warehouses and cooling facilities. The largest park in Haridwar, 200 kilometers from Delhi, is still under construction. More than 40 food processing companies will establish businesses in Haridwar. Short distances and fast processing of fruit and vegetables are expected to reduce food losses. This cutting-edge plant for fruit juice is still under construction, and it's just one of many. Soon, the world's largest food park will produce 6,000 liters of juice an hour. Asia's biggest multinational mill is located next door. The mill has a daily output of 100 tons of wheat flour. Currently, parts of the packaging are still done by hand. Indian manpower is cheap, but every contact with human beings presents a health risk for the consumer. The 2011 Indian budget gave approval to set up 30 mega food parks across the country, a project of superlatives.
We envisage a future where food parks would be present all across the nation, all across the country, bringing about a revolution in the way food is processed in India and reduce farm wastage to a large extent. Bridge the infrastructure gap, that is our current hurdle. Secondly, we also expect each food park to generate revenues of close to $1 billion and provide direct employment to over 40,000 people, 40,000 families literally, or 160,000 people.
India is preparing to become the world's food basket. The Indian Institute of Packaging in Mumbai trains packaging experts from India and from all over the world. These experts contribute in reducing food losses in their country through the use of new packaging technologies. Food production will have to increase by 70% over the next 40 years. By that time, the average food losses of up to one-third in developing countries must be reduced. Experts from Africa are particularly interested in this issue. Africa's population is said to double by 2050 to reach 2 billion. Currently, a quarter of all food produced in Africa spoils before it's eaten. That is a basic problem all poor countries are facing.
The Institute of Packaging has taken an initiative to organize the workshop or a training program on food packaging and to upgrade their knowledge in terms of latest trends and technology in food packaging, especially for the African citizen.
Leading industrialized nations have set standards for food processing. They've even succeeded in processing sensitive products such as milk and meat, thanks to efficient logistics. Cutting-edge processing and adequate packaging guarantee effective production and the highest possible standard of hygiene. To become a global food industry leader, India is planning investment of about 16 billion euro. One reason why German and Indian associations have established close partnerships over recent years. German manufacturers of food processing machinery and packaging machines have operated here in India and around the world for many years. India has become one of the most important sales markets. Over the past 5 years, exports of German technology to India have more than doubled. For small businesses in particular, India is still a great challenge in terms of cultural difference, climatic conditions, and mandatory Indian technical regulations. India represents an important sales market for machinery manufacturers worldwide. In Germany, losses of food between the field and food processing amount to just 4%. The chances for German know-how are considerable. According to experts, India is set to become ever more important even on the geopolitical scene. Some entrepreneurs have identified the potential and engaged in substantial investment. The Indian market will become one of the world's key markets. Germany depends either on exports or the cooperation with other nations within international networks. India is expected to become one of the world's most important nations, and Germany needs to be part of this process. Rice is one example that demonstrates India's potential to establish further links between productivity and quality and hygiene standards. Along with maize and wheat, rice is the world's most grown staple food. In India, white rice forms part of daily life, but hardly anybody knows of its complex production process. A mill first separates the grain from the chaff, or more precisely, the rice corn from its husk. The husk is used for heating, as animal food, or as natural fertilizer. The load on the truck is compressed by human feet to save space. A vibrator separates the cleaned rice corns from those that need further threshing. Natural rice is brownish because it's surrounded by a nutritious silver skin. To make the rice shine white, every single corn has to be polished 3 times. The quality of rice is determined by how many corns are broken. Lots of broken corns indicate poor quality. In India, even this job is done by hand. Any remaining dark rice corns and other impurities are removed by a high-tech machine with sophisticated high-speed cameras. The falling corns are detected and analyzed. Dark corns are immediately blown out by a high-pressure jet of air. This procedure ensures white and clean rice of such high quality that it's suitable for export. A prime example in the application of state-of-the-art technology. With its output of 130 million tons of rice, India is the world's second largest producer of rice. Indonesia ranks third and produces just half that amount. LT Foods Limited is among India's top rice producers. Thanks to high-quality processing machinery and packaging, the company exports 50% of its production. The company's rice is even available in Germany. LT Foods could be a role model for the future of Indian food in world markets if they meet set standards. India has the potential to become a leader in the global food processing industry and capable of feeding other parts of the world. Social changes, a well-organized infrastructure, and efficient logistics are essential in effectively fighting world hunger. The example set by India demonstrates that modern processing and packaging technologies are important elements in the struggle for final victory in the war against world hunger.